Hello again, this time from Switzerland. I am in Switzerland having just been to the Geneva Motor Show. Now, I've been at the motor show for a day and a half, and I was there with the intention to actually do some filming, put a vlog together about the show, show you all the cars, etc, etc, etc. But Geneva is such an enormous event, and it's so noisy and busy and social, I decided that making a video of any form was going to be extremely difficult. So I sacked it off. But it doesn't matter, because, as I say, I am still in Switzerland, although I have now left Geneva, as you might have guessed. I've headed up to some snowy mountains with a rather awesome car. So, whilst the Geneva plan didn't quite go well in the form of a video, what I am able to show you is something, I think, a bit cooler. So I'm here now with my friend Tim Hutton from Private Motor Club magazine. We've jumped into a car and we're heading north to Germany, to the Nürburgring. And well, let me show you what we've got. I'm not really dressed for winter, other than a jacket and boots. Are you dressed for winter, Tim?
No.
Were you planning on being in the snowy mountain?
Not especially planning, no.
But we are. So I thought it's probably best if we sit in the car to explain what on earth are we doing. So Tim is the owner, editor-in-chief, head creative, mega boss man, supreme king of all things at Private Motor Club magazine. The poshest, most exclusive car magazine in the world, quite possibly.
Yeah.
And Tim is a very old friend of mine from way back when.
Eight, 9 years.
Nürburgring. Nürburgring memories. And yeah, so we do a lot of road trips together. We go on a lot of driving tours together. We do all sorts of fun things. So this is just another one of our little adventures. But Tim, why don't you tell the lovely people that are watching... Why don't you tell the lovely people watching a little bit about Private Motor Club, what it is, why you started it, and why we're now in a Bentley driving towards the Nürburgring?
Yeah, well, we started Private Motor Club because we love printed magazines. Growing up with cool car magazines when we were kids, and being a designer, I just love printed things rather than websites. Films, obviously, that's the way everything's gone in the last few years, but I like to hold a nice quality book with nice photos, and so that's how the magazine came about. Making it the most exclusive magazine in the world, we only print 1,000 twice a year, and try and tell some wonderful stories with these road trips.
Yeah.
Find some interesting roads and moments, like snowy roads in Bentleys and crazy deserts in Dubai. And
the spontaneous stuff is always the good stuff.
It is, yeah. This is very much unplanned. Wicked.
So what's the plan now? We're going to set up some cameras and do some filming.
I think we should do some filming, take some photos in the snow with the cool Bentley.
Yeah. And then stick the old POV on.
Yeah.
The old POV.
Pretty good at that.
And I'll do some driving whilst you do some photos, getting wet feet.
Fantastic. Yeah, perfect.
So here it is. This is the car. This is a Bentley Continental GT Speed Edition. So it's the, I guess, must be nearing one of the last of their runs, I'd say, with the Bentley models. Would you think that's fair in saying?
Definitely, yeah.
15, 16 years now, the Bentley Continental has been a thing. At Geneva, Bentley did show us the XP9. Prototype, which is kind of like a hint, I think. It's like a, this is probably what the next Continental is going to look like. And it's a fairly cool looking thing and kind of the right direction I think Bentley need to be heading in. But as I say, you know, after 15 or 16 years, this is a car that does need to be replaced. And ultimately, how much is this, Tim? £220,000 for a car that is 16 years old, for a shape that is 16 years old. And in the UK, a car that you're actually able to get for about £20,000 if you want to get an early one. So you can see what I'm getting at. Lots of snow falling on the car. Right, so we're in. This is actually the first time I've driven this car. I have driven many, many, many Continental GTs, but this is the first time I have driven this one on this road.
Just go forward about 5-6 meters.
Yeah.
Then I'll just get some shots of the back and then I'll walk past you.
Cool, just scream when I should stop. So as I said before, it is a car that is 15/16 years old. The interior has changed a lot from the original model. So if you've seen the early ones, they've got a very obvious Audi gear change gate, as found in the A4, A6, A8, that sort of stuff. Of course, it is an Audi running gear, so you can't really blame them for that. But as the years have gone on, the infotainment systems, the control consoles for the central heating, that sort of stuff, and the instrument clusters have all changed. I think originally there were two very deep holes, one for the tacho, one for the speedo, whereas now it's a nice, you know, attractive dashboard cluster. Exterior wise styling has been tweaked, but interior is where the real good stuff has happened, I think. And Bentley, of course, is a premium product, and I think they can warrant selling these for the price that they are selling them for, because of course people are buying them. So that's the biggest indication. I think if people stop buying them, then we know why. So we are about to leave the snow behind and join the motorway. Good noises.
Turn left in a quarter of a mile and turn onto the A12.
Tail off.
We're not convinced by the sat nav in the navigation system.
A bit retro. It's a nice way of saying.
Like 16 years old retro.
Yeah.
Keep straight on this road for a long time.
Thanks a lot. For a long time. Not 5 minutes an hour, a long time. Just passing by the town of what was it called again?
Wangdorf.
Wangdorf. The town
left now
of Wangdorf. Wangdorf.
Wangdorf. Nothing funny about that.
Keep straight on this road for the next 3.
What did you get?
I got a Ben & Jerry's cookie dough witch.
Witch?
It's not actually a witch. They've just shortened the word sandwich down to witch.
You see.
Just to be clear, I'm not eating a witch.
That's good to know. That's what I got.
Gout.
Not yet. I'm going to take over the driving now and take us onward to the Nürburgring.
Oh, very nicely timed.
Awesome, isn't it? I don't know if I can use it in my video though.
Depends if you want to make any money out of your video.
In fact, there's one thing I'm going to mention. You will notice, or you may have noticed, we may not care. And excuse me for eating. I've had to put adverts back on my videos, which was something I basically always said I wouldn't do.
But the reason I've had to do that is because if I don't have adverts at the beginning of my videos, then Google will not prioritise them on YouTube because they can't earn any money from them. So I have had to put adverts back on. I apologise. By all means, skip them. Like, close them. I have no interest whatsoever at all in earning money from YouTube. I do this just for fun. So please do bear with the adverts, and I apologise for them. But that is the way the world has to be. Somebody out there has to earn money from it. It's not going to be me. But because they can't earn money, I can't get videos viewed. And a man from Google told me that. So thanks, Google. Oh, good. The navigation's cancelled itself because obviously we hadn't reached our destination, turned the car off, and it just assumed that we probably had.
Check into the lovely Tiergarten Hotel, owned by Sabine Schmidt and her family, and of course tuck in some rather special local food. So we have made it to dinner, we've made it to our favourite restaurant at the Nürburgring.
Oh yes.
And we have steak and a stone. For those that know, this is one of the best places you can eat at the Nürburgring. You cook your own steak, it comes out raw, like that. You cook it how you want it. Bon appetit.
Good morning. Well, we are at the ring. So we've arrived. We had a lovely dinner last night. Steak on the stone, just to prove where we are. Look, that's the castle. And we've been hard at work this morning already. We've been having meetings, and we've just finished our last meeting, and now we're going to head up and basically have some fun with our friend from our last meeting, who you may already know. Hi.
How are you doing, comrades?
Oh, doing well.
Very well.
It feels like at least 10 minutes since we've seen each other.
Yeah, 10 minutes ago. So we quickly run inside for 5 minutes video.
Yeah.
Oh, you have extra issue.
Uh-oh.
Thank you very much.
Ah. Oh, and
for
an
all
extra.
Of you who are watching.
An extra issue, not an issue, as in a bad problem.
No,
I
no,
thought.
No, no,
I
no,
thought.
No.
Oh God, what's he found on the roof of the car? It's yeah. Actually an issue with Private Motor Club.
Issue of Private.
So Misha's jumped in with us, and he's very kindly going to take us around to a couple of very cool workshops and businesses that are just about to happen.
Just about to happen.
I'm not going to include all the details in this video. I'm going to put those into a separate video, so something like cool things coming soon to the Nürburgring. But I've been told to expect exciting things.
Absolutely.
And what are your impressions on our rather lovely Bentley?
On your car? Yeah, so since we are mostly checking cars performance-wise, I'm pretty sure it's a nice Autobahn cruiser. But I doubt its capabilities on the Nürburgring because of the weight.
It's
and
a big old heavy car.
Yes. Recently, I think one of the CEOs of Bentley, or even Bugatti, said that average Bentley owner has like, what, 20 cars? Or 10 cars?
Really?
Yeah, I think so. They said that the difference between Bentley owner and a Bugatti owner. So Bentley owner has 20 cars on average, and he travels and stays like in very luxury hotels, but the Bugatti owner has 60 cars and he stays in his own hotels around the world. So there that's the difference. So, yeah.
But here's my question for you, which is the my focus of, the, well, it was certainly the question I asked myself at the beginning of this video. This spec, with all the spec, all the options, everything on this car, this is a £207,000, was it? Or I think it was the speed.
Six or seven.
So some, let's say £210,000.
Mm-hmm.
In the UK now, you can buy one of these from the early era, which is amazingly 16 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
£18,000 if you get one with a lot of miles and perhaps you know, damaged wheels, etc. etc. People out of their minds buying one of these for £210,000. Do you think?
It's a good question. I don't want to sound negative about people who do buy them.
Mm.
But I think the people that do buy them, they don't care about the price and just buy them because they have the money, they can spend it. They can buy 10 more cars and they wouldn't care about it either.
Yeah.
So if the car depreciates even next week by half of the price, they wouldn't care.
Exactly.
So if you want to show to the outside world that you give zero, you just buy this car.
Exactly. We are done here at the Nürburgring. We've finished our meetings. We've had some impromptu tours of some very exciting up-and-coming businesses and workshops and factories and things like that. As you will see from the little spin-off video that's going to be coming very soon, all thanks to Misha. So yeah, we've got a nice 5-hour drive to endure. I usually go right back through Kelberg. All right, let's see what it says. And the winner is... I don't know if we mentioned it, but we're not delighted with the sat-nav system. Did we mention that yet?
No.
No. I think it would be good to end the video. Catching up on something that I started talking about when we were when I was setting up cameras and stuff in the big snowy mountainy thing, and that was yesterday. Isn't that mad to think that
it's crazy.
Yesterday we were in the Swiss Alps, that evening we were at the Nürburgring, woke up at the Nürburgring this morning, had a whole load of meetings this morning, went and did mucking about things with Misha, took a fairly scenic drive back via Brussels, and now we are on a train under the sea going back to the UK before I go home and you go home.
Yeah.
But what I was trying to get at was, I started this video by saying this is a 200 and something thousand pound car, and it's one that you can buy for £20,000 in the UK if you're happy to buy an old one. And then I kept running that question through my head, how is it still a thing? How 15 years later is this platform, this shape, this car so obviously recognisable as the same thing that came out in 2003? And more so, how are they still selling them? But I think Misha hit the nail on the head today when he gave his Russian insight into the Bentley Continental and Bentleys in general, and that's that the people that do buy these cars, they do so because they can, and they don't really care that it is a 15-year-old platform. And that does kind of make sense, because although, yes, it is an old car, yes, it is an old shape, yes, it's heavy, the sound system's not amazing, the sat-nav system's a bit rubbish, you know, there are plenty of things you can find to moan about on this car. There are also things that are really good about this car, and the fact that it's still selling for £200,000 15 years after it originally started selling kind of does prove that it is actually quite a good car.
Yeah.
It is a GT car. We've used it for GT purposes. We've done grand touring in it. It is extremely comfortable. It wafts along. It's got all the power you would need. You're not losing anything. I don't think you're losing out necessarily in choosing anything else over a Continental in the same price bracket. I thought I was going to moan about this car. I thought I was going to end this video going, oh, it's 16 years old or 15 years old. Why are people still buying them? But I now know why. amazing car, amazing things Bentley are doing, and amazing future ahead of them. But that's enough for now of us rambling on. I'm going to say, as I always do, thank you very much for watching. It's great to see my channel growing and people getting excited about the fact that it's a fairly new channel, and people commenting and saying some really, really lovely things. And I really do like it when you comment. So please do feel free to comment. Let me know what you thought about this video. And it works both ways. If you think it's absolutely rubbish, then again, you know, tell me about it and I'll improve on it or tweak things or change things. Tell me what you liked, tell me what you didn't like. Feel free to subscribe. It's always nice to see that go up. Notifications and all that sort of stuff. Again, completely up to you if you want to do it. Just fun for me to make them, and if I know that people are enjoying them, then it's even better for everyone. Do make sure that you go and check out what this man does. So PrivarteMotor.Club is the magazine. I've included a few snippets of the magazine in this video, as well as a quick look at the website. But do take the time to go and have a look, because it's all pretty cool. All of Tim's Instagram stuff is below in the description. Likewise with Private Motor Club as well, so make sure you give both of those accounts a little follow. And I will see you very soon with more adventures. In fact, we've got an adventure coming up soon with a load of classic cars.
We have, yeah.
In Coventry.
Glamorous Coventry.
Glamorous Coventry in classic cars.
Motor vehicle.
Exactly, exactly. So thanks for watching. See you very soon. This has been great fun. Be good. Peace out. Good night. Bye-bye.
See ya.